Buenas tardes a todos los presentes.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Casa Árabe.
Hoy damos comienzo.
Today we are beginning a lecture series with 11 lectures on the great capitals of the medieval Islamic world, past and present, which Casa Árabe is co-hosting between now and November with the Tres Culturas del Mediterráneo Foundation, with the support of the Sísifo Research Group from the Archeology Department of Cordoba University. And the goal of this lecture series is to approach, led by specialists in the field, the history of some of the most important cities in Islamic history, which at some point became capitals of a major medieval kingdom or empire. In these lectures, we will discuss their golden age as well as their urban development from a critical current perspective, heritage preservation, and the remains of the cities which still persist today, so that in each particular case we can analyze the status of their historical heritage, whether it's well preserved or abandoned or ravaged, as well as the impact of different wars or real estate development. This lecture series is part of the activities which Casa Árabe is hosting to celebrate the 1300th anniversary of Cordoba as the capital of Al-Andalus, a time when Cordoba became the capital of the Al-Andalus Emirate and one of the centers of political, economic, and cultural power in the history of mankind. Today, we open the series with the first lecture on Damascus, change and continuity in the Middle Ages, with an exceptional speaker, Hugh Kennedy, who is professor of the language and culture of the Near Middle East at London University and one of the most prestigious specialists in medieval Islamic history in Europe and Asia. Hugh Kennedy is a member of the Center of Iranian Studies and the London Middle East Institute, the School of Oriental and African Studies, and is currently co-heading the Economic Integration and Social Change in the Islamic World System 800-1000 CE project, and he's published a broad number of articles and publications dealing mostly with the ancient territories of Syria and Iraq. His lecture will deal with the history and topography of Damascus from the Byzantine period to the 12th century. And in it, he will talk mostly about the relevance of the city as capital of the Umayyad Caliphate and the changes that it experienced when the Abbasid Caliphate reached power, as well as the role of the Seleucid dynasty. We'll hear about the city plan, the Umayyad development, and finally we will hear about the current situation of this historical city in the 20th and 21st centuries. To introduce him, we also have Rafael Blanco, who is a professor at Cordoba University and who's contributing to this lecture series as well. Before I give them the floor, I'd like to thank them both for joining us today and all of you. I hope that you will enjoy the lecture. Thank you. Thank you very much. I want to thank Casa Árabe and, of course, the Tres Culturas Foundation for this initiative in hosting this lecture series, which I don't think we've ever had anything quite like it in this country, and it's a very good way to celebrate the 1300th anniversary of Cordoba. So 13 centuries ago, Cordoba was the capital of Al-Andalus. It was an extremely important city since it was the center of a whole empire, but it was also a link between East and West, Europe and Africa, Christianity and Islam, and also within that often misshandled concept of the three cultures. But in any case, it was a great center, and it lasted well beyond the Umayyad Caliphate. Even today, there's constant references to Cordoba beyond our borders, and even also well towards the end of the Umayyad dynasty. As we know, Cordoba, when Argur was transferred from Seville, when transferred the capital city from Seville to Cordoba, began a very important period in which the Umayyad dynasty was strengthened until in 1629. The caliphate was founded until the beginning of the 11th century, which, when with the fitna of the civil war, that dynasty was toppled. This city, the Umayyad capital, was extremely important in the medieval world, and it was a great cultural and political center, a unique reference, which we can maybe compare today with such great cities as Pericles, Athens, Imperial Rome, Beijing under the Ming Dynasty, Madrid under the Habsburgs, and Paris under Napoleon. In that context, in my very modest contribution to this lecture series, wanted to bring together a list of great capitals which at that time had close ties with Cordoba in different ways, and which were also great capitals of different kingdoms and empires, beginning today with Damascus, which was the origin of the great Umayyad dynasty, to other major cities like Baghdad, for the Abbasid Empire, Cairo, for the Aghlabi Fatimi dynasty, also in the west, Fez, with strong links with the Andalusi world. In fact, one of its neighborhoods was founded by citizens of Cordoba who left the city at the beginning of the 9th century, or Marrakesh, which was the center of the Almohad Empire, and other centers in the peninsula like Spain, Murcia, which was the capital of one of the major Muslim kingdoms, and also Granada, of course, the last remnants of Al-Andalus, all of which had constant links with Cordoba the capital, and which themselves became great capitals. To do all that, we are going to bring what I think is a wonderful group of researchers, of experts, like today with Professor Hugh Kennedy, who's, it's really a huge honor and a great pleasure to be able to open this lecture series with him. You've already heard his resume, which is very extensive, so I'm not going to repeat what's been said. I'm sure that you're quite familiar with his work anyway, basically because of the huge number of publications he has and the tremendous quality of his work and his research in philology, archaeology, history in general, everything from Al-Andalus to Iran. In fact, recently I think he's just come back from Iran, and we're very happy that he could join us today. Thank you so much for being here again. And of course, his bibliography is so extensive that I'll just mention a few, very few of his publications, which you probably know, like the early Abbasid Caliphate, Political History, Crusader Castles, Spain in Muslim Times, a Political History of Al-Andalus, the Byzantine Empire, the early Middle East, the great Arab conquests. He now has in the works, let's say, the caliphate, which is also very comprehensive, looking at caliphates in general in the past and also in the present, and a great number of scientific articles, which quoted a tremendous amount about a very interesting topic for me personally, which is the transition between the ancient world and the medieval Islamic world, which he's covered in on many occasions, which I find fascinating. And all of these extremely extensive and profound topics with tremendous ability. It's really admirable. There's few researchers that have access to that kind of analysis and depth. And I often wonder how he manages it. And he says in his very modest way. I don't remember whether it was in the book of the Great Arab Conquests at the beginning of that book. He argues why or how you are able to approach such extensive topics with a general view. And there's a phrase which I really like, which says something like, we are standing on the shoulders of giants, of course, Sartre quote, which means that we are stand on the shoulders of those who reached very high before, and it's thanks to them that we can look further and higher than they did. I think, however, that of course, he himself has become a tremendous giant, maybe standing on other giant shoulders, and the rest of us in the future will try and climb on his shoulders if he let us at some point. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, ladies, and thank you very much to our two speakers, to Rafael and to Pedro, for this wonderful introduction, which is more than I deserve. And thank you very much to all of you for coming along this evening. What I'm going to be doing is talking about the history of the city of Damascus, as you know. But I'm very pleased that this is part of a series which encompasses so many other cities, and particularly cities in the Maghreb and in Al-Andalus and so on. And it comes back to Cordoba again, as Rafael was saying. I'm just finishing. In fact, I'm reading the proofs of my latest book, which is in my briefcase just upstairs here, which is a study of caliphate, ideas of caliphate through the Islamic centuries, from the time of the death of Prophet Muhammad right up to the 21st century, to get some idea about what caliphate has meant, all the different things that caliphate has meant to different Muslim communities at different times in Islamic history, and try and give something of the richness and variety of the Islamic political experience and the ways in which the ideas of caliphate have been exercised. And that, of course, has brought me back to the capital cities of caliphates, to Cordoba, which I've written about in the context of this book, but also back to Damascus, back to Baghdad, back to Cairo, and so on, because caliphates and cities were integrally linked together at various stages. And most of the, or lots of the great cities of the Islamic world have been, in a sense, at one time or another, the site of caliphates. But I come to Damascus as well in a spirit of anxiety, because, as we know, Syria has been for the last 4 years the site of the most horrible and intensive and prolonged civil war it's possible to imagine. And the damage that's been inflicted on the society of this small country is simply appalling, and it's still going on. The ancient city of Damascus remains largely unscathed, at least physically, in the sense of physical destruction. The city intramuros, the city inside the walls, has not been affected by this dreadful warfare as much as other places. And we have to think of Syria throughout the centuries has been dominated not by one great city, but by two. And the other of those great cities, Aleppo, has suffered in the last 2 or 3 years and is still suffering today the sort of destruction that means it's hard to imagine how it can recover from that. The destruction not only of major monuments, the wonderful 12th century minaret, which was such a symbol of the city, but also of the whole network of souks and so on, which were one of the great treasures or one of the great delights of the Middle East in the years before this terrible conflict erupted. And so, talking about Damascus, we must give thanks that so much of the fabric of Damascus has escaped, but that doesn't stop us being sad about Aleppo and anxious about the future of Damascus. These ancient city are, in modern term, faced with modern technologies, so fragile and so vulnerable to rapid and, in many cases, destructive change, that we have to treasure what we've got and value what we've got. And I think it's against this somber and sad background that we that this talk about Damascus begins. I first went to Damascus in 1964. I've been travelling to the city, therefore, for over half a century. And I've been and visited lots and lots of times. No, I won't say I've been every year since then, because I haven't, but I've been there lots and lots of times. And I've seen the city change. I've seen the city develop, not always in good ways. But I've acquired, I think, over those many years, a feeling for the fabric of the city, a love for the fabric of the city, its people, the ways in which the urban environment has been developed and has changed with the passing of the centuries. And it's something of this delight, I think, it's something of this enjoyment of the city that I'm going to try to share with you this afternoon. I wonder if it would be possible just to have some of these lights a bit down, because if we can do that, it will mean the images are much brighter. Otherwise, yeah. Yes, I hope that's going to make the images a bit more visible to you. I start off with one of the earliest European images of Damascus, a 17th century engraving, which actually looks nothing like Damascus at all. It's a purely fanciful idea of a city in a plain surrounded by walls with quite improbable and unrealistic mountains around it. But it shows perhaps the impact that the idea of Damascus had at one stage on the European imagination. Much more helpful in understanding the topography of the city is this early 19th century Bartlett engraving here, where we see we're looking from the mountains to the west of the city, the Mount Kasyun that overlooks the city, down over what was a separate, not really just a separate suburb, but a separate community at Sorhia, where the great mystic Ibn al-Arabi and other people are buried, and it was partly a resort town for getting away from the heat of Damascus, and partly a saint place where saints were buried. And we look over from Salah here, you can see in the foreground here, we look over to over the trees and gardens to the city of Damascus in the plains, and then beyond then to the gardens of the other side of Damascus and the desert beyond that. And we see in this engraving how Damascus is framed and formed by the waters, by the rivers that come down from the mounts of Lebanon, the river Barada, and so on. Damascus would never exist but for these ancient river courses, which bring water to potentially fertile land on the edge of the desert here. Nowadays, of course, this view looks very, very different. All the bit between Salah here in the foreground of this picture, all the has been Salah here, and Damascus at the other side has been completely built up. It's now all roads and concrete houses and modern development of various sorts. But it does make the point, I think, this photograph, or this engraving about the physical position of Damascus. And because of its natural oasis, because of the way that the rivers water the plains around, it has been the center of an urban culture since whenever, possibly since 7 or 8,000 BC, possibly since the Neolithic period and the beginnings of first settlements in the Middle East. And the archaeology of that period is completely lost as far as Damascus is concerned. But it must have been that the first settlers, the first villagers in the Neolithic period established some sort of center at Damascus. But it's really the historic town that we're looking at, and indeed the post-classical town that we're looking at. This map here shows Damascus in the early modern period. And of course, the thing that we immediately notice with this image of Damascus is the city walls. I'm sorry. The city walls that surround the ancient core nucleus. One of the most remarkable things about Damascus in terms of the historical topography is that the city walls as we see them today, and they're, apart from a small quadrant in the southwest, they're all still standing in one form or another, that the city walls today are, as far as we can tell, the same city walls as they were in Roman times and in early Islamic times. And indeed, the narratives of the conquest of Damascus by the Muslims in the year 636 specify which city gates, which of the Muslim commanders camped outside. And the remarkable thing about this is that every single one of those city gates is still existing and goes under the same name as they did in the early 7th century. There is no other city in the Middle East, and in fact, actually with the possible exception of Rome, very few other cities in the whole of Western Eurasia where you get this continuity of named topographical features, continuity in this case of named gates. And it points to the fact that the city walls that encompassed Damascus in the early Islamic period marked the boundaries of the old city right through to the present century. Within the old city, there is a network of streets. And this network of streets, though it is in many ways been changed and altered over the centuries, still fundamentally reflects the pattern of the streets of the Roman city. And this is the second thing that I'll come to in a bit more detail. And you can see, I hope, on the... towards, I'm trying to get this arrow to work for me, but it's not doing it exactly. In the southern part, you can see the big east-west street that goes through the city on the about two-thirds of the way down in the city walls there. And this straight street that runs through the city is exactly the Roman... goes on the site of the Roman main Roman street, the city that is called in the English version at least of the Acts of the Apostles in the Bible is called the street called Straight, and it was called the street called Straight because it was straight. And this the site of this major ancient highway has, as far as we can tell, been the line of the main street of the old city of Damascus ever since. Clearly, things have changed. The street level has risen during these centuries by perhaps 7 or 8 meters, and the buildings have obviously changed and developed. But it is a witness to the extraordinary continuity of Damascus that we can still trace the ancient Roman street plan in this way. Two other buildings dominate that I'll be coming to again. The first is the Umayyad Mosque, which I'll talk quite a lot about. And the Umayyad Mosque is a wonderful illustration of the continuity of sacred sites through the millennia. It was probably, and we can't prove this because it's never been the site of an archaeological investigation, it was probably the site of the temple of the god Hadad, the thunder god, or of the Canaanites that we hear about. And it was certainly the center of the Roman cult of Jupiter and the amalgamation, the linking up of Hadad and Jupiter. It's, of course, typical of the syncretic approach that the Romans had to, as it were, amalgamating ancient local gods with their own. It was certainly, too, the site of the Christian cathedral of St. John the Baptist. And it was absolutely, certainly, the site of the Umayyad Mosque that still exists down to the present day. Again, an extraordinary continuity of the occupation of sacred sites. Let's go on. And here we can see a reconstruction of part of the street network of the eastern part of the old city. This one developed by the great French Syrian archaeologist Jean Sauvager in the 1930s, in which Sauvager attempted to show with these broad, with these heavily marked streets, the amount of the old streets that were amount of the present streets that actually ran along the site of the old Roman streets, and though the street pattern looks a bit chaotic, so much as shows how the Roman streets still define the streets of today. And this is how Sauvage sees this process. And this is an extraordinarily interesting and, I believe, influential piece of theoretical archaeology, of archaeological modelling that Sauvage developed. And what he's doing here is trying to show how ancient cities develop into medieval ones without losing their sense of direction and so on. To understand this graph, this illustration, we have to work from the right-hand side and read it to the left, a bit like Arabic, I suppose. And on the right-hand side, we see the broad colonnaded street of the classical period with its big square shops, its colonnaded streets, its broad pavements, and so on. And then as the centuries go by, and Sauvage thinks that this was quite a late development. I would think that it's rather earlier, probably in Byzantine times. Look what happens here. Are we okay? Sorry if it's been a bit echoey. What happens here is that the shops start coming onto the pavement. The sidewalk is built over. And then in the third stage, so to speak, the shops actually come onto the main carriageway of the street. And then, as time goes on, the main carriageway of the street is completely built over with shops, and the traffic or the people go around the side, in that grey bit down the somewhat on the sidewalk. And then, as we see, as time goes on, that the main part of the carriageway is main part of the street is completely built over, and that the road goes to one side of it and the other, and so on until we get to the far left hand end where we get three or four different narrow streets. Now the point that Sauvage is making is that this is all on the same site, that the if you see the line of the pillars of the classical street, they're still the way all the way through. But the street has changed and been adapted as time goes on by different people for different reasons. Why are they doing this? Well, for archaeologists of Sauvage's generation in the 1930s, 1940s, the explanation was essentially one of decay. The administration was failing. All the elegant layout of the classical city was abandoned by people who didn't understand it anymore, who were just prepared to let things go and so on. But I think in the last 20, 30, 40 years maybe, we've come to see this in a slightly different way. People are using urban space in the center of Damascus and in other cities in the Near East in different ways. What are these different ways? Well, I think there are two or three changes going on here. One is that people aren't using wheeled vehicles anymore. This is a really strange thing that the great American Middle Eastern historian Richard Bulliet pointed out in a book, very influential book called The Camel and the Wheel in the 1970s, that wheeled transport almost disappears in the Middle East between the end of the Roman Empire and the 19th century. People didn't move stuff on carts. They didn't ride in chariots. They didn't use wheels at all for transporting things. And instead, they transported things on pack animals, on camels, on mules, on the backs of human porters. When I first went to Damascus in the 1960s, a very common sight was the porter, the hamal, with his huge bird bent over, usually an old man bent over under the huge weight of the furniture, logs, pottery, whatever he was carrying. The hamal no longer exists and hasn't, thank goodness, for years, because it was a back-breaking occupation, and people nowadays use sort of tuk-tuk trucks and little motorized things and so on and so forth. But the point is, from the topography, if you stop using wheeled vehicles, you don't have broad, wide streets anymore. They're no use. There's no point. Much better to use the space for setting up shops, for retail space, as a modern urbanists would say in English, for building shops and so on. So the disappearance of wheeled transport means that you use the streets, you use the urban spaces in different ways. But there's something else going on here too, and that is that the city is thriving in the sense that more people are wanting to have shops and little retail outlets in the center of town. If you look what goes on the right-hand side of that, the beginning, as it were, of that diagram, you can see there are four big shops, and that's what there is. If you go to the other end, the shops are smaller, but there are many more of them. What we're getting at here is that you've got more, as I say, shops, retail outlets, call them what you like, in the same sort of urban space. It's not a center sign, therefore, of decay or abandonment or anything of the urban center. It's a sign that there's more demand, that the market is growing. We need to have more shops and so on. And something else, a third thing coming on, which is just appearing recently. I have a colleague who's in fact, involved in this economic history project, a man, Fanny Bessard, who's a young French scholar working in the UK at the moment. And she has pointed out how the nature of business changes. In Roman times, things were made in shops on the streets. And so, as it were, manufacturing and selling, making and selling, happened in these big enclosures here. But by the time that, as it were, the mature Islamic economy, manufacturing and selling have in many cases been divorced from each other. The manufacturing goes on in different quarters of the city from the selling. And she's suggesting that's one of the reasons, again, why you get much smaller shops. They're not workshops anymore. They're just places where people sell things. And so, one of the signs of continuity that I'm so interested in the case of Damascus and other cities, but it's particularly obvious in the case of Damascus, is the way in which the city keeps its vestiges, traces of its street plan, but actually the urban environment is used in different ways and to different purposes. Let's go on a bit. Here we've got another map here, just to illustrate it. This is a map that I drew for the an atlas of Islamic history I did for Brill. And it points out the position of the mosque, which is the reddish building, and the position of the citadel, which I'll come back to, the line of the old city walls, and the main streets. And here we see, this is rather fanciful, a romantic watercolour of the old streets of Damascus here, and here a view of the city walls. You see what's happened to the city walls? They're still there. The city walls, as you can still see the stone of the city walls. And in fact, just recently, for the first time ever, the city walls of Damascus have been surveyed archaeologically by Jean-Michel Mouton of the Sorbonne. And I hope this is going to be published soon, because it will help us a lot to understand the different stages of the development here. But you can see how in the, really from the 16th century onwards, the city walls ceased to be military in function. how people build houses on top of them and sticking out from them and so on. But nonetheless, the line of the city walls is preserved. Perhaps because people have built houses on the top of them, they're not demolished. You don't get that clearing away of city walls, which is so typical of French and Spanish cities, indeed. During the early modern period, the city walls are redundant, they're useless, they prevent economic growth, get rid of them. Here in Damascus, you couldn't do that because people have built houses on them. And that, in a sense, has preserved the line of the city walls, I think. And the city walls were constantly repaired and refurbished through the Middle Ages. The gates were rebuilt and rebuilt. This is an inscription put up by the celebrated ruler jihadist against the Crusaders, Nur ad-Din, ruler of Damascus from the 1154 to his death in 1171, but I maybe got those dates slightly wrong. But that sort of period, and he rebuilt a lot of the towers of the city walls, and he put up this great inscription to say that he'd done it. We still see, sorry about this photograph, it's a really dreadful, grubby thing, but we still see in some places, and particularly the Bab Shaki, the eastern gate of the city, how we can see the actual fabric of the Roman gates. And the fabric of the Roman city doesn't just exist in the city walls. It exists as the backbone of many areas within the city. Here we're looking at a Roman arcade with probably Umayyad, that's early Islamic, arches on the top of it, which leads to the great mosque. And we see here the classical fabric with the great classical portico, you can see in the background under the arch there, still surviving, remodeled during the Umayyad period, that's the into the 8th century, but still using a lot of the classical fabric. And many of the streets, the stone foundations, the stone lower levels of houses like this, must date back. We don't know when they date to. We're not the sort of building by building survey, which we could do and things were happier and easier in Damascus. We don't know the exact ages of the walls of any of these houses, but we must suspect, and we've got one or two little bits of evidence, that we must suspect that a lot of them are simply the walls of Roman houses reused in different ways. And so it is in many of the straight but narrow streets. But while there is a lot of continuity in terms of the city walls, and as I've suggested, in terms of the street plan, the coming of Islamic rule also marks a major development. And the major development is one of the most remarkable buildings in the whole corpus of Islamic architecture, and that is the Umayyad Mosque in Damascus. Built in, you can see it there, just as minarets poking on the skyline. Here is a photograph that gives them a clear idea of its relationship to the rest of the city. And from an urbanism point of view, it makes a number of points. The surroundings of this great rectangular enclosure are the Roman masonry blocks of the temenos, the enclosure wall of the temple. We can tell they're Roman. I mean, they're obviously Roman because they're very much bigger than the blocks of later builders. And when we come to look at the Umayyad building, the Umayyad extra, we see that the size of the stones has decreased. Roman stones are huge. Umayyad stones are comparatively small. And the reason for this must be, I think, the change of transport. The absence of wheeled transport that I talked about before means that you have to carry your stones on the backs of camels and mules. And that means your stones actually have to be quite small. For though camels and mules are strong animals, nothing like strong enough to transport the huge blocks we find in the Roman architecture of the temenos. So that outlines the Roman temenos, outlines the precinct of the mosque. But what the Umayyad builders did, and we know that this building was constructed in the reign of the Caliph Walid I, that's 705 to 715, was to reconstruct this holy place for Muslim worship with a great prayer hall on the south side there and the dome over the mihrab and a huge courtyard. But this photograph makes, so the reuse of the Roman space is clear. But this photograph also makes another point, I think. And that is that the mosque is the one significant open space inside the walled city. It is the one public space that is inside this otherwise very, very intensely developed area here. And so the mosque has replaced the church and the temple, obviously, but it's also, in a way, replaced the agora. It's replaced the town square. This is where, when a new governor is appointed, he comes along to give the khutbah, just as Roman governors had gone to the amphitheater or the square to deliver their political messages and so on. The mosque takes over the function, not just of the religious buildings of antiquity, but also the social buildings of the city center. There's another slightly different view of the same, making the same point, and another view of this extraordinary building which still dominates the skyline of the old city of Damascus. That's a not a very good photograph, I'm afraid, of the great square there. If we look at the plan, we can see the outlines of the Roman temenos and the prayer hall on the south side, and the much later minarets that are put up in the 15th century, this one by the Mamluk Sultan Great Bey, attesting again how this mosque has been embellished and reinvigorated by later rulers. Another view of the courtyard of the mosque, this huge open space. And you can see how much in many ways it represents, or it reflects the colonnades that would surround the agora or the square of a Roman city. And this strange and rather bizarre looking building that stands on the pillars that you see there is again a reflection of very ancient practice. This is probably the treasury that was put there, the public treasury that was put there by the Umayyads. There's a tradition in the Islamic history and architecture that the treasury, the Beit Mal al-Muslimin, the house of the money of the wealth of the Muslims, was put up not in some corner of some citadel or in some hole in the ground, but in a public place. And this building, it seems to reflect that practice. It was probably a communal treasury. But it's had a long and interesting history. Some people, incidentally, have suggested it's a Byzantine baptistry, but I don't think this can be the case. But it's in its long history, it served lots of different purposes. And in the modern period, from about the at least the 15th century and probably earlier, probably the 12th century, it was used as a repository for ancient documents. Now, as we know in the history of the Islamic Middle East, documents perish very easily. We don't have those great collections of documents in the Islamic Middle East that we have, say, in the record collections of Western European monasteries and those charters that we get to see. For example, in the monasteries of northern Spain, those charters which go right back to the 9th and 10th century, those sort of documentary resources are largely absent in the Islamic tradition. But when this treasury has been investigated, it actually contains a lot of medieval documents of one sort or another, pilgrimage certificates, wills, transfers of land, and so on and so forth. And it's proved to be something of an archive in its own right. But again, perhaps typically, its history has been very obscure. Quite a lot of the stuff was taken to Istanbul in the years before the First World War and has effectively never been seen again. It's known to exist in Istanbul, but it's been very difficult to get access to it, not entirely because of the opposition from the text. But it's also, but bits more things have been discovered in there recently, and just a very intriguing fragments have been discovered, which my colleague Conrad Herschler at the SOAS has been in very interested in. They discovered in the amongst the Arabic documents a number of texts of old French romances, old French heroic poems, and so on, in the mosque, in the treasury of the mosque at Damascus. And this is really very, very strange, isn't it? What was it doing there? How do these bits of old French romances come to be in the treasury of the Muslims here? Now, there are quite a lot of explanations that you can advance. One of them is, of course, that they were captured and brought to Damascus, but at the time of the fall of the Crusader states. But another and much more interesting speculation was that people in Damascus were actually reading old French romances during the period of the Crusades. And if that's true, and it would be nice to think that it was true, if that's true, then it would suggest that Damascus was a meeting place of Eastern and Western cultures in a way that we haven't really thought about it before. I leave that with you. There's no way of proving these things at the moment, one way or the other. What is clear is that substantial fragments, as I say, old French romances, were found in the Ghaznic in Damascus. Let's move on to see some more of the building here, just as illustrations. Look at this one here. We can see this is part of the Umayyad portico of the mosque in Damascus, but we can see here how closely it reflects the Byzantine late antique traditions of building in this part of the world, with the tall columns and the marble panels on the walls there. Sorry, that's a terrible photograph, I don't want to show. That's another view of the main. And then when we look inside, we can see the most extraordinary building. This is by far the biggest surviving structure, as far as I know, that was created anywhere in the world in the first half of the 8th century. The scale and ambition of the prayer hall of the Mosque of Damascus puts anything that was created in Western Europe. Think of Anglo-Saxon churches or those little Moth Arab churches that you find in central Spain. It's 10 times as big as any of these things. The sheer scale of the building reflects the wealth and ambition of the Umayyad Caliphs of Damascus. But all is not quite what it seems here. This building is certainly of the scale and size of the Umayyad prayer hall. But the prayer hall was burnt out in a disastrous fire in 1893. And what you see now is a late Ottoman reconstruction. But there are photographs survive. This photography comes to the Middle East quite early. There are photographs of Damascus in the 1860s and so on. But photographs of the pre-fire prayer hall of the Great Mosque still survive. And we can see here how the Ottoman prayer hall reflects the size and scale of it. But we can see here the fabric of the Umayyad building very, very clearly. In fact, a colleague of mine at the University of Edinburgh, Alain Georges, is just producing for the first time a proper architectural history of the mosque in Damascus with using computer graphics to reconstruct what the original Umayyad thing was looking like. And I think when this comes out, which it will quite soon, we'll get a much clearer idea of the architectural stages of it. I'll go on. Another thing that is worth looking at in the question of the mosque in Damascus is the mosaic decoration. And here again we see a continuity with the antique pattern here. The decoration doesn't survive in the interior of the mosque because of the fire, but it survives in the colonnades around the courtyard here. And we see this extraordinarily rich mosaic done in the Byzantine manner. Done, that is, it's glass mosaic. It's not the sort of stone floor mosaics that you get in that part of the world, but it's glass mosaic put up on the walls so that the different facets of the glass mosaic reflect the light in different ways, which means the glass mosaic is not a flat, lifeless picture at all, but it's a picture that's constantly moving as the light changes, as you change, as you move around, look at it from different angles, you see different facets of each of the tesserae of this mosaic reflecting in a different way and bringing the whole surface to life in a way that no photograph can ever do. But this is and inside the colonnade are these extraordinary representations of what seem to be a garden of paradise. They present a landscape which looks like the landscape of the Ghouta of Damascus, with rivers running by. So there's a river at the bottom of this one, with big tall trees and little village houses on little paths up there, and so on. But there are no inhabitants. Nobody, not even animals, nobody lives in these houses. Or if they do, nobody shows themselves. It's a completely aniconic representation, which seems to reflect certain Islamic prejudices against the showing of human beings, but at the same time, it evokes this wonderful landscape, half a reflection of the landscape around Damascus, half a reflection of what paradise might be like. And some of the architecture, that last one I showed you, was very much little village houses. Some of the architecture is very sophisticated take on elegant classical designs. It's very difficult to work out what's going on in this picture. Are we to understand that the top bit is a bridge? If we look under the bridge, we see a village house in the distance there. Or are we to understand that this is a semicircular architectural feature? But anyway, it is a very interesting discussion of classical architecture in a way that perhaps the great masters of 17th, 18th century Rome, Borromini and so on, would have looked at and recognized had they known about it, and saw people again trying to do different things with the classical canon. And that's perhaps what these Umayyad builders are trying to do. They're very intriguing and very difficult to be certain about. More of the same, that's another one. And these little... So what we see is the development of the ancient city within its city walls, the changing of the street plans, the coming of a new public building, but nonetheless a fundamental continuity in many ways with the classical past. And something that's worth pointing out, that Damascus was the capital of the Umayyad Caliphate. Everyone knows that because it's written in the history books. But in fact, the Umayyad caliphs very seldom stayed in Damascus. Muawiyah, the first of them, 661 to 680, built a palace there. But none of the rest of the Umayyad caliphs are ever recorded as having stayed in it. They lived in all sorts of places. Some of them led a transhuman life from the Bekaa Valley in the winter, in the summer, high up in the Lebanese hills. Then in the autumn, they would pass through Damascus. But they stayed not in the city. They stayed in a monastery outside called Deir Mouran. Whether it was still a monastery or not, I don't know. But the idea of Umayyad caliph staying in monasteries is itself quite an interesting one. And then in the winter, they would go down to the Sea of Galilee, where they built a palace, or a number of palaces, by the Sea of Galilee, where it was warm and right through the winter. And then in the spring, they would go the other way and so on. But this meant that Damascus never expanded like Baghdad did. Baghdad was a real capital from 762 onwards of the Abbasid caliphs. Huge numbers of people flocked to Baghdad to make money. Lots of new buildings were put up, and the city expanded and expanded till its population may easily have reached 500,000. That never happened in Damascus. In the Umayyad times, it was always a big city, and it had the Umayyad mosque in it. but it barely expanded beyond its city walls. In the 12th century, something new happened in the topography of Damascus, and that was the development of the citadel. We get this process throughout the Middle East with the coming of Seljuk rule from, well, the 1050s onwards. We get urban citadels appearing, big castles within cities. This wasn't an early Islamic thing at all. But we see it in Cairo, the development of the Cairo citadel in the 12th century by Salah ad-Din and so on. We see it in Aleppo, where the citadel that stands on the ancient tell was not really inhabited in the early Islamic period at all. Nobody seems to have used it. But it's fortified in the 12th century with the ring of walls and that magnificent gate house, which may not be surviving to the present day. Almost every city you look in, from Merv in Turkmenistan right through to the Mediterranean coast, almost every major city acquires an urban citadel in the 12th and early 13th centuries. And so it was with Damascus. I'll just have to leave it there. I may get more photographs. I thought I got more photographs at all. The other things happen as well as the citadelization. Another important architectural feature appears in Damascus, and that is the madrasa. The madrasa, the theological college, the oldest theological colleges in Damascus, seem to date from the very end of the 11th century, but it's not really until the 12th century that madrasas start to appear in the urban fabric. They're educational centers. In early Islamic times, education took place in the mosques, or teachers taught in their own houses, or in the houses of great nobles. There was no infrastructure of education, a distinctive infrastructure of education. In the 12th century, all that changes. Again, everywhere from Turkmenistan to Cairo, that changes. Right the way to the Atlantic Ocean, in fact. You get the development of the madrasa, an absolute characteristic feature of the urban fabric, and Damascus certainly had its fair share of those. But what I wanted to finish up with, and I know that the time is running ahead here, is the wonderful legacy of early modern housing, 16th, 17th, 18th century housing that we find in Damascus. A legacy which, until about the last 20 years, was hardly appreciated or noticed. But in the years, the couple of decades before the start of the Civil War, these houses became more and more appreciated with their, this is an 18th century example, with its stone courtyard, its trees in the middle of it, right in the heart of the old city, with wonderful boiserie, wonderful woodwork, and so on. And here we see these Damascus interiors, still many of them surviving. And this is a courtyard that was what they call a car in Syria, an Ivan for people to sit in. These houses were one of the are still, we must hope, one of the great pleasures and delights of Damascus. And it's interesting to see, I think, how each century seems to contribute something more to the development and the richness of the urban fabric. And 17th, 18th, 19th century, these Damascus houses are the great achievement. This is back to the citadel. I'm sorry, these photographs come in the wrong order, and my apologies for that. This is the citadel of Damascus, and you can see what an impressive and imposing military thing it was. The citadel, as we have it today, was mostly built in the early 13th century. It was built by one of the Ayyubid rulers, the brother, in fact, of Saladin, who died in 1193, constructed this citadel. And it was designed, not as you might imagine, to protect Damascus against the attacks of the Crusaders, but to defend Damascus, the princes of Damascus, about against the attacks of their cousins, the other Ayyubid princes, who wanted to take over the city. But the architecture is something completely new in the city of Damascus. These Muslim military buildings of the early 13th century are very and startlingly similar to Crusader castles of the same period. These box matriculations that you see on the outside wall here, this bossed masonry, the masonry that is sort of chunky and sticks out at you, both these are features we find in Crusader building of around the year 1200. But what, intriguingly, we don't know is which way the influence goes. Were these styles of building that were developed in the amongst the Muslims and the Crusaders adopted, or did it work the other way around? I think the balance of evidence is that this is a Crusader build. These are Crusader building styles which are adopted by the Muslims, but it's open. What is interesting, perhaps, is the way in which architectural technologies transfer across the Muslim-Christian frontier, the Frankish-Muslim frontier. Both sides are building in the same way, using the same technologies. And it is most likely and probable that they were using the same workmen, that different groups of workmen were building for a Muslim prince one year and a Frankish baron the next. It would be interesting, wouldn't it? Think about those French romances in the cousin as well. More of that. This is an inscription of the Malik al-Adil who built this. And so we move on into the modern period, and here I just want to show one, two bits of modernism here. The laying out of new squares outside for the first time in the early, well, in the 1880s really, but then onwards, the city moves outside the city walls and develops area like this Merge Square, which is now dominated by the huge, grotesque, and unfinished Assad library, a huge concrete skeleton, which completely dwarfs the rest of the buildings. But here we see the Merge Square, obviously in the early 20th century, I think probably just before the First World War here, but there are certainly cars in the streets there, aren't there? And its column commemorating the railway line, development of the railway line from Medina to Damascus to Medina, and these beautiful old Ottoman houses. And a whole new souk, a whole new bazaar was created in the center of town called the Hamidiya Souk, in honor of the Ottoman Sultan Abdul Hamid II. It lies along the lines of an ancient souk, but it's building up its covered top, its Ottoman period shops and so on, are still the commercial heart of old Damascus. And it acquires the railway station, of course. This is what being modern means in the first decade of the 20th century. It acquires a railway station from which the trains used to run right down to take the hajis, to take the pilgrims down to Medina. And it was suitably embellished outside the city walls, of course. It was suitably embellished in a sort of neo-Moorish style, shall we say. And sorry, I'll just leave that on the thing. And it represents, well, not the end of Damascus at all, but how Damascus was developing at the time of the First World War. And then, of course, the city develops enormously afterwards. What I've tried to do in this lecture is to, for those of you who do, and also for those of you who know Damascus, and for those of you who don't, how the city has constantly renewed itself, has been constantly developed in different ways by different generations, but has retained the basic outlines, the city walls, the main streets, the central holy place, despite the appearance of all sorts of different styles of buildings, the citadel, the madrasas, the great 17th, 18th, 19th century houses, the modernization that's represented by the Merge Square and also by the railway station in the early 20th century. Nonetheless, right up until the 20th century, Damascus has this extraordinary continuity of development. I can think of no other Middle Eastern city where you get this sense of the long durée, the long development of an urban center, each century contributing its own distinctive style, to this wonderful richness of building and environment that we found in old Damascus. Let us hope that it will survive the cataclysms and disasters of the present decades, and it will still have that richness of urban texture, that delight in life and different styles and so on, that will, let's hope it will still give pleasure to our children and grandchildren to come. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much.